You know, gamers are often known as nerds, but nerds are passionate people. Up next, we have one of the coolest games ever, Dota 2 by Valve Corporation.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Ucypher League. My name is Vivek, with me is CloudX, and you're watching the Yakshas take on the Crusaders. The Yakshas, they're coming into this with the momentum of sorts. They won the earlier game of Counter-Strike Dota today, and it remains to be seen whether they can close the game of Dota. With Punk back on the squad, I definitely think they can.
It's a Remstar versus Acrid plus Punk matchup. Two of the olden gods of Indian Dota, or should I call them dinosaurs of Indian Dota, going up against Remstar himself. I'm curious to see whether or not Crusaders has studied the patch and if they're going to be able to bring something new to the table here. We've heard from behind the scenes that Yakshas do have something up their sleeves.
Yeah. I mean, we're getting access to where even the cameras are not going, and that's the players having tea. And in these small, quick, brief moments, we do get some sort of insight into the draft. For now, the Crusaders and Darshan in particular, he's banned out a bunch of heroes that he's reasonably strong on, the Earthshaker as well as the Legion Commander. And the Yakshas, straight away, they pick up the Bane.
I'm not a fan of this,
man. Not a fan?
Nope. I mean, Bane definitely did seem like he was one of the super buffed heroes in the meta, but I personally, the only game I actually did on the new patch was with a silly mid Bane coming up against me. Sure, I lost the lane, but what does the Bane do after that? Still the single target source of damage, still the single target source of lockdown, which really isn't the most impactful in the mid game stage.
And this Bane pickup, for those of you wondering why Bane is a hot pick, basically he can attack you during Nightmare without waking you up, and that's gonna help him deal a lot of damage without taking any. A. B. It's really great in a one-on-one scenario. If you're running him as a traditional support, Nightmare is the Nightmare, and you want to use Nightmare to set up for something more meaningful, sure, there's a couple of auto attacks do help. But I'm not... I mean, the only reason why Bane is so strong is because if you run him solo, somebody's going to end up losing the lane. That's where he excels.
So my point is that happens regardless of the patch. Right. Enfeeble was always a good spell.
Right.
The only thing that really changed about the Bane is that he can hit you through the Nightmare.
Right.
And I don't think that's enough incentive to go all out nuts building Mask of Madness and such. Sure, there's a talent. There's one of the choices of talents where you can pick up Enfeeble stealing damage from the enemy core, which is always nice. But do you really want your physical DPS hero to be a Bane? I don't know, man. I'd say he's way too squishy for that.
Okay. Crusaders, though, they're a little more traditional. They picked up the Jakiro, who's still a strong pusher, great in the lane and harassing enemy offlaners, and they picked up the Underlord. Now, teams that have played a lot versus the Underlord will know that the Ursa does particularly well versus him, and Crusaders haven't banned it out just yet. I like the Underlord pickup, and I like this even more.
I like what Crusaders are doing a lot more, man. Just yesterday, we talked about how one of the best ways to approach the patch is to push and catch them off guard.
Right.
Shadils, you know, for lack of a better word, they half-assed it. They didn't quite get their push rolling altogether. But Crusaders, it seems like they've sort of got this really potent tanky push coming out. Multiple units on the field with Chen, lots of AoE control and damage with the Underlord, and of course Jakiro to help take down the towers. Between a Bane and a Clockwork, I just don't see how they stop this.
Turn to pick. Faceless Void. Huh.
I had a feeling this was leading towards an Invoker, but the Invoker's been banned out. And look at this, the Crusaders, they're not hesitating one bit. The aim is to push, and with the Drow Ranger augmenting the creeps coming up from the Chen as well as the Jakiro, they should be pushing hard and fast pretty early on. While Yakshas, it seems as if they want to drag this game out. I like the Void as a pickup, in the sense that the Chronosphere can bring down a crucial hero who really helps the Crusader push.
5 seconds remaining.
I don't see the synergy, man. I think Yakshas' draft is just all over the place.
Yeah.
Tinker great at one point now versus stopping the push, but if you use your Glyph of Fortification correctly, you can go up with invulnerable creeps and you essentially waste the Tinker's Smart Spams for a couple of waves.
Right.
Crusaders, they're not really relying on any particular creep wave to push out the high ground, right? They've got themselves a Drow Ranger who hits from a fairly long range. You've got yourself the Liquid Fire, which you can walk up and spam. And if you really want something to soak up the damage in the front lines, your Underlord is probably going to build a pipe later on. And the Chen is going to have creeps that are more tanky than you can deal with just a Marth spam.
And Underlord has a talent as well in this new patch, which allows Firestorm to affect 20% damage or something like that.
Build one of those meteor hammers on top of it, and you can see you're building every 40 seconds.
5 seconds remaining.
Indeed. But I, to some extent, I like what the Yakshas had drafted. In a sense, the Void can really pick up one of the crucial heroes on the side of the Crusaders and hold off the push for a bit. His Chronosphere is going to be extremely crucial, and it remains to be seen who's going to really benefit from that Chronosphere.
I think if Crusaders last picks a Beastmaster here, it's basically over. I don't see how Yakshas stops that push with a Clockwork and a Bane as your support. They have only the Tinker for Wave Clear. And I don't think Crusader should really be that bothered about having anyone Radiant's jump in on the storm behind. When you go breaking buildings, you're basically done. Medusa is going to be the final pick. Again, something into the late game basket here coming out from Yakshas. They've made their intentions clear. They want to hold the push off in the early stages of the game and take this game for as long as they like. Crusaders, on the other hand, it's a stark difference between the lineups here. Crusaders want to end within the first 30 minutes of this game.
Yeah, the Crusaders want to end early, and a couple of items are going to be key for that. The Chen picking up his mech, maybe the Underlord, a couple of Arcane Boots, a Basilius of Lads, because both of them stack nowadays. Yeah. I mean, you can stack the mana region from the Basilius along with the two mana region coming up from the Vlads, if I'm not mistaken. And they're really going to need that up against the Medusa. Pipe is also going to be crucial somewhere down the line. Andro just needs to get the Dragon Lance in as many cheap stats as possible.
Beastmaster or Dragon Knight?
I think Dragon Knight. I think you go Dragon Knight.
Blink Dagger Dragon Knight? A way to jump in on the Tinker behind?
Yeah.
Yeah, I could get behind that. He's gonna have the Dragon Blood armor as well to help him in the face of Faceless Void, but. And of course, a Medusa for that matter. The only real drawback of a Dragon Knight would be the pure damage coming out from the Yakshas, but they'll go with the Wind Ranger. That's. Left me scratching my head. I mean, there are a couple of changes to the Wind Ranger. For one, the Focus Fire now allows you to dance around like a little fairy while you're shooting out those arrows.
Yeah.
Makes her a bit more mobile.
I don't know, maybe they just want a solid mid laner.
But Remstar's picked up the Wind Ranger. Okay, they're gonna swap
swapped it up.
It up.
Yeah. So it's invincible on the Wind Ranger.
Nope, Sengen on the Wind Ranger. Support Wind Ranger. Invincible Jakiro. This is not something he plays.
Okay, so we're seeing a mid Jakiro then. And we're seeing his support Wind Ranger, but really is Wind Ranger the support you need? I don't know. I don't think so.
I don't think so either. But I guess with the damage boost coming out from Remstar's Draw Ranger, it could work well for them. What's the offlaner here for Yakshas? They're going with a Void in the offlane?
Yeah.
The best way to deal
is that offlaner.
The best way to deal with an offlane Void is to either have lockdowns in excess of 2 seconds or to have damage over time. With the Wind Ranger and the Jakiro, they basically got both. So I'm not too far. Well, Jakiro is mid actually. Between the Chen and the Wind Ranger, they actually have both.
They swap things up once more. It seems as if nobody wants to play the Wind Ranger.
Alright, Invincible
and,
will
and
be
I don't
Wind
blame
Ranger.
Them. It does stand out. I'm not sure why Wind Ranger. Focus Fire is going to help to some extent along with the draw and the precision aura.
There's no sugarcoating it. This is an early to mid-game push coming out from Crusaders, and this is a late-game Turtle 4 Protect 1 sort of playstyle coming out from Yakshas. My only drawback is I don't see the synergy, and I don't see too much wave clear to deal with the push.
Right.
And I don't see it, and all the more so when the pipe comes online for the Underlord. That's the crucial timing I think we've got to watch for before they go onto the high ground. Darshan getting a pipe.
Yeah. So, I'm not entirely sold
on the supports that are beneficial.
You can Nightmare into Cogs and you can Nightmare, pound away on the target, just walk up, get the Cogs, and hopefully, if you do manage to catch either the Jakiro or the Chen out of position, they're pretty much dead. Mm-hmm. So both the Jakiro as well as the Chen have got to respect that. And it seems as if the Yakshas are running an aggressive tri lane of sorts. The Medusa, the Bane, and the Clockwork. It's a tri lane that doesn't have obvious synergy. The supports do not have any great synergy with the Void either.
You've also got to remember that this is an aggressive tri lane run against a Chen who's going to come in with creeps that you just cannot deal with at the early stages of the game.
So, I mean, other than all the neutrals having a better cast point of 0.1 and some of them consuming less mana to cast their spells. One of the bigger changes to Chen is that Test of Faith can now be used defensively as a heal. So you can cast it on the teammate, you can cast it on yourself it heals for the full value, and on teammates it's, I mean, like, it's a random value.
So, look, let's be very clear about how they're trying to win this lane, right, as an aggressive try. The theoretical combination is you Nightmare into Cogs and beat up on the guy that's stuck in the Cogs. Yeah. Nightmare works well versus single targets, but when there's multiple heroes in the lane to swap off that sleep aggro, I don't think it's the best way to go.
Right.
Add to that the fact that Chen could just take away the aggro, the Nightmare aggro, or the Nightmare debuff with one of his creeps. I'm not a fan of this tri lane at all, especially if the Chen decides to move bottom early on, but look at this. They got scared. I mean, they just spotted this tri lane and decided to rotate themselves. Remstar's gone top, and they've actually sent Darshan to the bottom lane.
Okay. I'm not sure how they spotted out this tri lane. Is there a Radiant Observer nearby? I didn't see them walk up.
No, I didn't see a Radiant Observer either, but I mean, maybe they saw...
Okay, it's possible they saw the Dire safe lane.
Yeah, that's the most likely option here. So Remstar's gonna go blow for blow versus Khalnayak on the Void. Void didn't start off with the poor man... Well, there is no poor man shield. Yeah, he started off with a stout shield. Anyway, bottom lane, here we go. They started with the battery assault over and above the sleep, but Darshan's super tanky. I don't think he's... Okay, maybe he is gonna die here. They've actually gone under the tower, but the return kill will be there, and DP is gonna be the one to go down. So Acrid may have drawn first blood, but they end up sacrificing their clockwork in exchange for it.
So the Crusaders need to realize that the Chen needs to get at least one creep before he's an actual hero on the map. He does need that one creep, and bad luck. It's a Wild Wing Ripper. I mean, it's going to hold off pushes to some extent, just be a nuisance, but it's not the ideal creep to be aggressive.
Oh, VP coming in with the boots. He's going to send Remstar all the way back again, but not too much of a bother for Remstar. He's got himself salve. He's got himself a salve and four tangos to work with. He's going to be just fine in the lane. Meanwhile, how's mid holding up? It's 2 CS on the Tinker, while none for the Windranger so far.
That's a bit surprising. Power shot at level 1, you should be getting the range creep at least.
Yeah.
I mean, the difference in terms of EXP between the range and the melee creep is now almost negligible.
No, let's not forget that this is a Windranger with the precision aura buff as well. So it's a little unlikely that... It's a little unusual for him to be falling behind in terms
that
of
That should
CS.
Be happening.
I don't think so.
Anyway, VP, again being a pest with those battery assault spams, but Bounty Room brings him up to level 2 and he has the cogs. He's got a cogs in his engine. This doesn't look like a solo kill, but it's definitely going to be a bit of a nuisance here.
Yeah, Senjin has 4 tangos, so he's going to spend his time off the map trying to heal himself up a bit. The tri lane, for all purposes, has fizzled out. They just wanted to give Acrid a good start, and Acrid, with a decent start, should be able to hold himself versus the Underlord.
Yeah.
What's the plan here? I would like to see VP as well as Punk work together with a little more synergy. I understand VP went to contest the Bounty Runes. Bounty Runes are valuable as always, but they haven't yet secured a kill, and hopefully they should do it soon enough. They've hit level 2. So one of the interesting changes in this patch is that it takes 40 points of EXP less to hit level 2. That's made up from going from level 2 to level 3, if I'm not mistaken. So it's kind of crucial for the Clockwork and the Bane to hit too. You got the...
It's also synergistic with the fact that the Bounty Rune now gives you more EXP as well. So getting that early Bounty Rune for the supports, or rather the 2-minute Bounty Rune for the supports, is very crucial.
It is.
We're seeing Punk move towards the bottom lane. Acrid is awaiting him there. But between the Bane and the Medusa, this doesn't seem like a kill on the Underlord, especially now that he's got a point in the Atrophy Aura. Top lane as well. Khalnayak has been farming quite well. He's at 11 and 7.
I mean, he's got the highest CS on the map right now.
And VP's coming in to zone out the Drow Ranger once again, except this time there is backup from Senjin. He's awfully low though. I don't know if it's the best idea for him to walk out into the lane, because VP could kill him.
Does VP have enough mana for both Battery Assault as well as Cogs?
No, at the moment he doesn't, but he does have a Clarity Potion to work with.
Quick reconnect coming out from Invincible. Hopefully the packet loss is sorted. 2 minutes in, the score's tied at 1-1. The Crusaders, there's a certain sense of pressure on them to start the push going. And so far, it is still early on. The Yakshas have managed to get a crucial kill to begin with. That to Undashin. The Windranger is not doing particularly well in the mid lane. And somehow Kalnayak has 11 CS. I'm not entirely sure how he has 11 CS.
I mean,
did he pull?
Remstar got zoned out by VP, so that basically gave him enough space and time to farm up here.
Okay.
I'm not too surprised, but the fact that he's got the deny advantage as well versus Remstar, that's a little surprising.
Yeah.
Anyway, Kalnayak is going to take a Frost Arrow to the face. Remstar, be careful. There's even an Orb of Venom on the Void, so with denied. The Clockwork, they could definitely make some kills happen.
Yeah, indeed. It's a kill that's possible. And Sendrin is just hanging around on the sidelines, hoping to secure the Rose Lane as well as ensure that the Clockwork doesn't rotate. I think that ward got spotted out.
Yeah, it should have been spotted
sure
out.
Sure, if the ward. Yeah, it does.
No, it doesn't.
No, it actually doesn't. Okay, the trees.
Anyway, Underlord is now feeling the brunt of this Enfeeble spam from
Do you think the point in Enfeeble is needed, or would the point in Brain Sap be a lot better?
I think it's the Brain Sap early on.
Yeah, because, I mean, sure, you're getting damage from the Atrophy Aura, but I don't think Darshan is going to use that to come and approach the Medusa and trade hits.
Exactly. And it's not like Darshan's really relying on auto-attacking to take the last hit either. He's
not
just dropping Firestorm.
It's Firestorm, and you'd much rather have the pure damage coming out from the Brain Sap, which could result in a kill if the Clockwork does manage to catch someone in the cogs.
Anyway, that's gonna stay set. Just started this on the bottom lane. But top, you've got Remstar duking it out with Kalnayak. This is... I think this is a lane with a disaster just waiting to happen.
I don't think
just
this is
walking
kill.
In.
This is... I mean...
If he got the cogs, that would have been a kill.
On Remstar. If he did on Remstar.
Even on Sengen. I think Sengen dies at this point. He's got 2 points in the time lock. One lucky bash in
Void
the
middle. Jumps in and...
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's too close to the tier 1 tower, so maybe that's a cause for concern. What's the Chen doing? I mean, he's just been AFK farming. We're not seeing him having an impact in this early game at all.
He's also put the point into Penitence over Test of Faith. I'm a bit surprised Test of Faith gives you heal as well. I don't know. I have mixed feelings about this, but maybe soon he'll put the point into Test of Faith. Rune picked up by Invincible, who's got an Invis rune in his bottle. And we have a crash coming in.
Slow and steady start here. 4 minutes into the game. The scoreline sitting at just 1-1. Neither side taking the lead.
Is Bakimoto trying to queue up a helm? Is that the player?
Huh. And then what, like get an extra unit and go charging down?
5 units.
Well, why not? Were there any significant changes to the helm that you remember?
No. It's not as far as I remember.
Alright, maybe there's something he knows that we don't hear. But I think it's fairly straightforward. Crusaders are just going to look to ride out the early game storm and then come charging through the gates once they get their first few items online. I'd like to see them go for a push somewhere around the 10-minute mark. That is somewhere, well, post the nighttime kicking in.
Yeah, you want Hand of God. You ideally want a set of Arcane Boots. Maybe the helm, which does give a flat out HP regen value of 8, which is reasonable. What's going to be crucial though for the Yakshas is to find that 6 on the Void and make sure they find a kill on a Core, stall off the push as much as possible, ensure that Darshan's not having a fun time on this Underlord. I mean, it's only been 4 minutes into the game, but both Punk as well as VP, they've sort of fizzled out in terms of impact across lanes. Darshan, he's approaching the creep wave, and that Atrophy Aura does hurt in terms of physical damage.
Yeah, this is a dangerous situation for Akko to be in. Darshan can walk up to him and smack him in the face a couple of times, taking away most of his mana. But elsewhere, it looks like Remstar ended up dying to VP and Kalnayak. We talked about how there was a kill possibility. Looks like they'll make it real. Punk's gonna come into the bottom lane. The sleep is there, along with a couple of auto attacks coming out from him on Darshan. He doesn't have a point in the Brain Sack. He went for a second point in Enfeeble.
Invisibility!
It's gonna come back to hurt him again, because they don't have enough damage to bring down that Underlord.
Oh. So, I mean, we spoke about this during the draft top lane, the Kalnayak being gone upon. He did commit the time walk. Sengen, he's got the dual drift coming off cooldown in a bit. But Kalnayak is safe. Mid lane, Bakimono.
Oh,
he's got two wonderful creeps. The shackle is there, March coming up from Appa. Creep after creep, continuous lockdown on the Tinker. He pops the fairy fire, but Invincible scores the kill. DPs are coming in, Punk. No nightmare. In fact, no mana for the nightmare.
Yeah, that, I mean, Punk's TP was useless. Even if he did make it in time, he wouldn't have been able to help at all. He had no mana for the nightmare and no brain sap to finish the Chen. There was also the fact that Tinker panicked a little bit. While it's very likely he would have died anyway, he could have considered throwing out an early laser while he was getting stunned up on the creeps around him. So they would have missed, there'd be an evasion debuff around him and he would have actually, he may just have survived that with the fairy fire.
Yeah.
But Chen's first rotation proves to be successful. He manages to score a very crucial kill in the middle lane Tinker, giving Invincible the upper hand in the laning stage, and now he's got an Arcane Rune in addition to 2 points in the Precision Aura to help commandeer this lead.
You don't need that.
Dire have the spyglass at hand.
I don't know. Do you want to keep putting points into Nightmare? Look at this. Bakemono looping around for what could be a crucial kill onto the Medusa. Punk might just tank the gank. He spots out the neutrals.
And that's just the retreat sign coming out for Bakemono. Meanwhile, top, the Chrono's been expended. They have Sengen hitting from the sidelines. VP will go down first, but so too will Remstar. Sengen just walked into the cogs twice afterward. They were laid in the same place.
Yeah, so Khalnayak, I mean, the Chrono was good. It managed to catch out Remstar, or mid lane, Invincible, with that Arcane Rune, doing some serious work, and a smoke team popped. But that smoke, it didn't amount to too much because Bakemono is already here. In fact, he's caught in the cogs and his creeps are being pushed back. He can't micro them. He's not doing much. He's running around like a headless chicken with VP running right after him. The battery assault, as well as the rockets, do a reasonable amount of damage. Can VP get the kill though? He's got cogs number two. He's caught Bakemono in them. The Centaur and the Hellbat Smasher being pushed around, and VP manages to bring down the Chen.
Third world micro problems at its finest once again. I mean, there was a point where the creeps could have walked in and tanked up the damage. If anything, it should have been Bakemono just standing his ground and fighting away versus the Clockwork then.
Yeah.
There was no point for him to run and have his creeps bump into the cogs twice.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's clearly evident that Bakemono is not too experienced on this Chen and he's having a hard time playing it here. Invincible. Fire on the Shackle shot, but what's the real use here? He's not going to be able to score a kill. He'll find himself a DD rune though on the top side of the river, and that could transition into another gank. We are seeing one group up for
like
a possible smoke.
Between. Oh yeah, it is the smoke like you mentioned, and you got Windrain just sitting a little bit above the Tinker. The real winners here are the Void as well as the Medusa, who both haven't died even once, if I'm not mistaken.
Watch for the gank though. They're grouping up behind Remstar, who's waiting for VP to come in from behind, and VP, he's broken the smoke and Invincible. He's right in the spot where the Shackles will almost certainly connect, but he's being stopped with the cogs in the battery assault. Invincible will get the kill with the DD rune, and they don't expend too much money.
To some extent, I do appreciate what Crusaders are trying to do. They know that Chronosphere is on cooldown. This is their opportunity to strike. They're going to try and do as much as possible. I hope they're keeping tabs on the Crusaders because it's coming up cooldown in a couple of seconds. The real question is if the Yakshas want to take this fight in the first place. With the Drove, with the Wind Ranger having a double damage rune, it seems as if the Yakshas have given up all hope of defending this tower.
Underlord has chosen not to join this fight though. Acrid, he's going to TP up to the top lane. Roots will not cancel it. He's got the Stone Gaze. The Chronosphere is there as well. The Ice Bar dropped down by Sengen. Now Bakemono trying to make a run for it, does drop down defensive test of Fate. Remstar being sent back home. Will he make it home in time? Looks like he will! Khalnayak, all he gets for a Chronosphere as well as the Stone Gaze is a kill on the Chen and a couple of his creeps, while all the while Invincible pushes the middle lane and Darshan pushes the bottom.
Where's the Tinker? What's the Tinker up to?
Very good question. He's actually walking around towards the top lane.
Okay.
He doesn't have a BOT, so he's not going to be able to join these fights quickly enough.
He needs to put a point into rearm. I mean, even if he can rearm the teleport scroll and just move across the map a little better, it's going to help him out. He's put points in the mark. I don't blame him. He knows that a push is incoming and he'd like to hold as much as possible. No, I mean, no real use in maxing up Razor this early.
I still don't. I cannot understand the
logic. Look, so Enfield Bill is going to hurt the draw when she wants to push, but as a Bane, there's no way you're going to walk up to the draw and get the Enfield.
And you're not dealing with the primary threat, which is the majority of the creeps coming out from the Chen and a liquid fire spammed on your tower.
Yeah, that's not what? Has Enfeeble range been buffed? he dropped Enfeeble from cliff to cliff. Does it?
I'm pretty sure this was always the case.
Okay. Sorry, my bad then.
Well, he's still got like 40 damage to work with.
I'll take that.
Regeneration!
Yep. He's got his level 6 online now, but it made that shackle connected. Who needs damage when you can land shackle shots like that? Look at this man. He's aiming in one direction and shooting in the other. This is the worst possible bug I've ever seen in Dota, but he's gonna get the kill anyway.
He played down from center. He toggles off the nightmare and that goes to show that even with the enfeeble opponent, it's still pretty hard, and this is gonna transition into a push from the Crusaders. Nobody's holding on to mid. Thinker, he's trying desperately to farm those BODs.
Acrid, well,
he's in pretty much a static lane where he's gonna provide a little bit of damage upon Remstar, but he's losing his mid tier 1.
You've also got to remember the Remstar did hit level 6 earlier on. He's got the maxed out precision aura and marksmanship kicking in. So the damage boost is absurd for Invincible. And Feeble is only doing a little bit against him at this point.
Dire's middle tower is under cover pressure.
He's not going to find anyone. Acrid is going to bail towards the north side with a TP available, while everyone else has jumped into the jungle.
Dire are standing already using echolocation.
Like to see a maelstrom early on. You think the link gets first? I mean, at the rate at which your opponents are pushing, do you have the luxury of getting a 22 minute?
I'd probably be okay in favor of cheap stats this game, which would be something like the Dragonlance early on. Not a big fan of Lincolns, especially because they're really not looking to target in this game. Their objective isn't to hit heroes, it's to hit buildings, and any source of damage that you can bring online to help deal with that is good. Lincolns is not a good pick in that department. Because let's face it, with the Lincolns, what does it do? It gives Medusa a bit more tankiness, right? Tankiness is not what she needs. She needs some sort of damage source when Kal'Nayan goes in with the Chronosphere. Right now, the most painful hero on the map for them, for better or for worse, is that Bane. But that's only with the Fiend's Grid. Tinker's not adding as much value because he hasn't maxed out the laser and the rockets, and it's unlikely and unrealistic to expect the entirety of Crusaders to stand in a march and take it in the chin. Bottom, they're trying desperately to chip away on this tier 1 tower, but look at this. The cavalry is prepped and ready to go with an ice path to set up the shackle shot. Acrid could be in a world of trouble. He's going to get spotted by a Dire Observer Ward. They'll start with the dual breath, and they're going to TP in the Draw Ranger as well. Invincible looping in from the side. Acrid going to get caught out here. Funk is waiting in the wings as well. He does get the Nightmare off in the nick of time, and then a defensive Stone Gaze will help Acrid get in position. Now the Fiend's Rip is there. Invincible caught completely isolated and out of position. They do get the Silence off from the Gust, but they'll get the kill on Invincible. The entirety of the Dire is here, but so too is the Chen and his creeps. They'll get one stun on Kal'Nayak, but he'll jump it off and move forward onto Bakemono, who's going to go down with the Mystic Snake doing some damage in the front lines as well. Remstar, next on the hit list, is going to be taken apart. He drops down a Gust and catches 4, but without the Underlord, where's the control and where's the AoE damage? 4 down on the side of Crusaders. Their push has been thwarted, and Yakshas will take a tower of their own.
This is the worst thing that could happen to a pushing lineup. When you want to push and it results in a team wipe, primarily because you are attempting to push 4v5, and you also attempting to push when the Chronosphere was available to your opponent. So, I mean, if the Crusaders want to go again, the time is now. They got the mech on the Underlord. They got the Arcane Boots as well. Probably wait for Bakemono to get a couple of decent creeps, not wait too long, and maybe go pushing again.
He's been useless.
Okay.
Chen's been useless for the most part. I mean,
he's carrying an aura, that's it.
I don't want to say this is Bakemono's fault. It's mostly because on that bottom lane, Invincible decided to be, I don't know, Wonder Woman and walked out forward on that Windranger trying to get a solo kill. That was just senseless. I mean, in the face of a Medusa at that.
The greed with which he attempted to position himself in the bottom lane just to land a good shackle shot really came back to hurt him. All of this is more than enough space for Appa to get some farm on the Tinker. Has he picked up his BODs? He should have by now.
Yeah, he's got a BOD and a soldier. And in fact, he's almost got his dagger as well.
Yeah.
He did get two out of the skills. Two of the skills were his. One of those was Invincible.
Yeah. This is an interesting turn of things, though. And I'm not sure if the Yakshas realize what's going on.
They do.
Punk's gone in. The Rocket Flare is there. Roshan dropping low. Punk goes in. Nightmare on to one. Invincible picks up the Aegis. The Ice Path will wave. VP not wanting to go in. And a defensive Kog should just run away. But turns around with the hook shot on to Bakemono. I mean, used to the hook shot, but doesn't get too much done.
What was he thinking going in there?
Yeah.
Incoming.
Huh. Interesting.
Look, at this point, with this creep army and with the mech online on the Underlord, they've got to just play five-man Dota.
Yeah.
It's textbook Dota. It's what you do when you pick up the game first and join with your friends. You just group up as five, take a tower, and keep going from tower to tower. This is the perfect lineup to do that. And at this point, I still don't think they have anything to deal with it on the side of Yakshas. Acrid got out here, does get tagged. The shackle shot is beautiful and it's perfect, but he's still alive through all of this. The Stone Gaze may just come out, and indeed it will. He's turned his back to all of them, and it looks like he's going to survive. There's a Nightmare on the front lines as well. Watch for VP walking forward. Watch for the Void coming in from the side as well. We should be looking for that Chronosphere soon enough. The healings are coming out. No one's died just yet. There's the freezing ice path on the floor. Khal Nayak caught with the roots once again. Acrid just surviving through all of this. Invincible doing no damage whatsoever either. But the Chrono, it catches just one while Khal Nayak is controlled by Chen's creeps and brought down by Bakemono. Beautiful stuff by him. It looks like he's redeemed himself.
Yeah, I mean, Khal Nayak was controlled by the Pit of Malice, and the Chen's creep ensured that VP couldn't really enter the fight on the clockwork. Puck didn't use his Fiend's Grip, and yeah, the power shot coming up from the Wind Ranger. Well, it ultimately made their smoke seem useful. They wanted a kill on Acrid, they didn't end up getting it. They instead got it on the Void and they forced out the Chronosphere. It's a win-win of sorts for the Crusaders. They still got Aegis, and I think they just need to maybe pop a Shrine and go again for round two.
I agree. I think they just go once again.
They need to waste as less time as possible.
That's really what has to happen.
Yeah, the wave is pushed in the mid lane.
Make the most of that Chronosphere cooldown. At level 1, it's 90 seconds. It's more than 90 seconds, actually. 140 seconds cooldown.
Okay.
You've got such a huge window of opportunity that you cannot afford to blow.
Push the lane, and I don't know, Dark Roof somewhere else.
Yeah, that could work, but...
You need to make the most of ages. You have to.
They're doing it. They're going for the tier 1 at bottom,
okay,
which is totally
fine.
Just
hit buildings. That's all. It's that simple with the drone. Remstar's got the 4 staff as well.
The good thing about what Yakshas has done is they've dropped a lot of wards. Oh, nice ice path. Appa caught with his pants down and might just be taken apart here. Invincible is not doing enough damage to him. Punk is coming in with a Nightmare to slow things down. Good save there from the Bane. He actually keeps him alive.
I'm a little disappointed with how the Tinker TP'd in. He TP'd into the midst of battle and nearly ended up falling. Maybe if Invincible had the focus fire and a little bit more mana, the Tinker would be dead. The Mart spam comes out. They end up trading a tier 1 for a tier 1. It's good to know that they managed to pick the mid tier 1, and there's an Enfeeble upon Remstar as well. Appa's got the blink. That's
Appa, if he had the blink keeping into the front like that was a big suicide.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he had the blink then though, but yeah, either
even
way.
If he did, there was an
questionable TP.
Him.
Yeah, questionable TP though. He could have cancelled his TP. Top lane, what are we missing? Nothing. Push number 3 coming out from the Crusaders.
Yeah, but the longer this game goes, the harder high ground is going to get, you know. This is a push lineup that was meant to take all outer towers by the first 15 minutes of the game, and that's not happened. All tier 2 towers still stand for the Dire. In fact, the Radiant have even got themselves 2 tier 1 towers of their own. They've got a net worth lead going into the defense. This is as good as it's going to get for Yakshas. Acrid's picked up his Lincoln Sphere. That makes him a bit more tanky on the front lines. We already saw him being nigh impossible to kill.
Yeah.
Punk's been an absolute pest with that maxed out Enfeeble. He just stands and puts it down on both the sisters. The Draw Ranger and the Wind Ranger take an Enfeeble to the face, and they do nothing for the remainder of the team fight.
Mm-hmm. And it's also damage that's being stolen
Radiant's
by the Bane.
Not yet.
If he's picked up his level 10 talent, he hasn't. Okay. Even then, I mean, maxing Enfeeble and not Brain Sap, I'm not too sold.
Yeah, not sold either. Maxing Nightmare and not Brain Sap is what I'm not sold on, actually. I wouldn't mind the Enfeeble max.
So how does Nightmare scale? It just gives you more duration, which leads to more damage.
Basically.
But do you want the Bane to actually walk into battle and hit people?
It gives you the cast range as well, which goes up to about 650.
Has Tinker picked up one of the newer items?
Oh yeah, he's actually picked up the Kaya.
Yeah.
So it's essentially the new Aether Lens, right? Because you get the spell amplification, you get mana cost and mana loss reduction. This is actually a perfect Tinker item in hindsight.
Yeah, plus 16 intelligence, 10% spell amp, 10% mana cost and mana loss reduction. Multiple instances don't stack, so it won't stack with the Veil though.
Aegis has timed out, and Bakken Mono, he's prepped with a whole bunch of creeps. One of them is for the Aura, two of them are for the Stuns, one's for the Purge, and one's for the Hellbear Smash.
all the creeps in the world, all the pushing potential in the world, ages in their inventory, and I still feel like the Crusaders have not done enough just yet. They're a bit scared to walk up into the march, and I don't blame them.
Appa's got way too much now. I mean, he's on top of the net worth charts. They had a window of opportunity to take away all of Tinker's space on the map before he got his blink tag, but now he's got a blink as well as the Kaya, so...
And he's still not, got tier 2 towers.
I mean, I feel like they've missed their timing window on the side of Crusaders. It's at that point where if Crusaders don't switch things up and do something desperate, the Yakshas are just going to push them into this slow and steady defeat. Sort of like a slow-growing tumor that's eventually going to get too large for them to handle.
Absolutely. I sort of understand where the Crusaders are coming for. They've realized that the Tinker has picked up a blink as well as his BOT. So Dashin, he's probably given the call that let's just wait out my pipe and then maybe let's push. But the longer you wait for items that help you push, the more ineffective those items get.
Absolutely.
Because it's not like your opponents are going to be static, right? I mean, they're also going to get bigger, better items and it's just going to hurt more. Medusa might have a maelstrom. Punk might finally put points into Brain Sap. The game is just going to get incrementally harder if you don't push early on. A push lineup works because your heroes push, not because you need all these luxury pushing items in the world.
Yeah, I agree.
And they haven't made their heroes work effectively.
This was meant to be a lineup where you just throw bodies at the tower while the Tinker cannot...
Yeah, you throw bodies at the tower!
While the Tinker can't get in position and defend. Now the Tinker's got a blink, he's got his Kaya. Even without the Kaya, the blink would have been enough for him to get away and mass spam from the sides, which is proving to be a problem. The pipe should have come before the Kaya, if that was what they were aiming for. But now that it hasn't, I don't think... I mean, the game plan is you just switch things up and go late game, even if you're playing with the early game push lineup. Uh-oh, Jokiro. Taken apart in the bottom lane. No Crota Spear required, just a hook shot followed up with Khalnayan jumping in. Another pick off, taken down by Yakshas easily.
And
what's a 20 second window again open up for them?
Yeah, it's going to buy them 20 seconds of time. I don't think Yakshas will get any objectives on the back of this, but it's 20 seconds of them farming, 20 seconds of the Crusaders not pushing, and they still have the Crota Spear.
Thanks!
What's. Also, worrisome to some extent is that Invincible's Aegis has not accomplished anything this entire game. They had Aegis, they didn't get too much done. And, I don't know. As time progresses, this Chen is going to start to feel more and more useless.
I feel like Chen's still one of those that can scale into the late game. Aghanim Chen is pretty damn scary when you come in with a set of ancient creeps.
But look at this.
The only reason that Yakshas are able to stall these pushes is because of the magic damage from the Tinker. They don't have any other wave clear in the source of physical damage like a Boundless Strike
mid lane.
Time and again, he is just out there farming by himself. And he's gonna get picked off again. This is the second time that Clockwork has committed a hook shot to score a kill on Sengen. This is not the way to play that in my position. I've gotta say, this one's all on it.
Yeah, I mean, Yakshas got the tier 2 in the bottom. They got a kill on the Jokiro. The Aegis has been taken away from the Crusaders. The Yakshas are working with a 4K net worth advantage. And they, in fact, even have an advantage in terms of towers. This is the lineup that was meant to push. The lineup that's meant to scale into the late game is actually working wonderfully in the mid game. The Crusaders have been goofed it up for earlier.
It does seem like it, man. It really does seem like they've goofed up a lot, because...
I mean, Bakemono is just... farming the jungle.
He's stalled at this point, Bakemono. Even though he's farming the jungle, he's just taking creeps from himself. He's not really earning too much money, not getting too much EXP out of this. And the fact that he's been stuck on that helm in the 23 minute mark when Chen is supposed to be a rather greedy support is not helping their case either.
Yeah. And he's been spending a lot of time in the jungle, just collecting creep after creep. But when are these creeps going to have any impact as far as taking down structures?
There's that maelstrom pick by the way on Acrid. So they have more sources of magic damage to deal with the push coming out here. So, and some creep here as well. But the pipe with Darshan, it's go time, man. I don't think you don't sleep around anymore. You hope to find a pickoff of your own with this Chen army that's about and try and make something happen. Invincible even picked up a blink dagger. So if they can somehow take out the Bane before he starts spamming those silly amphibians.
Okay, so they pop the smoke. If you take a look at Radiant Vision, all that they're looking at is where the old mid lane shrine used to be. And they do sense, however, that the Yakshas are attempting to push out top. Watch out for Kanaak. This positioning is going to be key so that the Yakshas can get a good Kronos and get the fight started. But VP, he pops his smoke. He's going to thank the gang. And I think he's absolutely okay with that. Round of six, I mean, excuse me. What? VP just hookshots out of there. And the smoke has been wasted. The position has been revealed. And the Kronos is there from Kanaak. Invincible from some outside the Chrono with the focus. But I don't bring down Kanaak. But Kanaak takes up Bakumoro. No hand of God is to fight. The ancient mysteries, the neutrals are there. But VP drops the box. Them back and Acrid is running straight ahead. There's the Infusion, there's the Nightmare, and there's Kanaak pounding away. No one's falling just yet, but Jakiro dropping low. A Fiend's Grip onto one. They're trying to focus the Underlord as well as the Pro. Nobody's falling just yet. The battle's still raging. Bakemono buys back. He has the Hand of God, which he already used, and he's gonna send Darshan back off. VP, no shot, can't bring down the Underlord. They lose the Jakiro. Bakemono dies and buys back as well. And the Kronos Wave is committed, not really getting a kill in exchange for the Yakshas.
That was confusing to say the least. I mean, you had VP was basically cosplaying Spider-Man when he hookshot it out of there. Then you had the Kronos Wave catching two on top of it. Crucial plays by Punk, standing far behind, gets the Enfeeble off on the Windranger, who's using the Focus Fire augmented by the Agnon Scepter. He's simply standing his ground and doing no damage inside of the Chronosphere, and that's why Kalnaik survives, and the spike just snowballs entirely in their favor.
So, can Enfeeble be dispelled by the Scepter?
No, I think it's one of those that cannot be dispelled. Yeah. No matter what you do, you cannot get rid of it, even if you pop a BKB after it. And if I'm not mistaken, okay, it doesn't fear spell immunity, so you could possibly walk in with a BKB and hope not to get immunity. Okay. But yeah, all that went wrong because BP decided he's gonna be Spider-Man and just hook shot out, not even giving him up the first kill there. Strange stuff coming out because the Underlord did have the time to sort of, well, once he got the Pit of Malice down there, he actually had enough time to walk around and try and block a hookshot escape on the other side. Yeah. Instead, he chose to walk behind him and auto-attack him over there. It doesn't work in his favor.
Smart money.
Darshan, the pipe, the mech, sure they've been tanky as all hell. That even was a buyback from the Chen, by the way.
Yeah,
the Papa Hand of God.
Got back to Papa Hand of God, which sort of helped keep Darshan alive. And Remstar. Got the Hurricane Pike complete on the throw. Invincible's got that link in that axe. We'll be hoping to make some use of it. I think he still needs a mainstream.
He needs a BKB, man. He needs a BKB so that he can start to fight Magic Immune so that Punk cannot touch him with a long range Enfeeble. That's just really what he has to do.
Okay.
It's such a high risk play going in with a BKB and hoping that someone doesn't focus you after.
Yeah, the BKB
going into
got Fiend's Grip, Kronos here.
Dire are standing for enemies.
But I'm not sure if it's going to be enough.
But
he
has queued up a BKB. If he does BKB and decides to start the fight, Void is just going to see that as an invitation to Chrono just the BKB Windranger. So that's his game plan here.
Or even the Fiend Grip.
Us with their presence in the
and
arena. And
then
I have the
you're
good fortune
hoping
of watching
that,
this game of Dota 2 with you
the
guys.
The Jakiro manages
What's
to cancel
on?
The Fiend Grip.
Well, Yakshas have the upper hand right now. And Vivek is really playing well.
There's so many ways to deal with it actually, because Vicky's got the hookshot which also goes for Magic Immunity.
They're leading the leaderboard with about 13 kills out here.
Invincible.
Wow. And Crusaders are absolutely but I think this would be a very late game.
Yeah.
Then we'll get inside.
Up and done for the spell life thing then?
Yes.
What is Medusa's power?
Don't
ask
me that.
I mean, if you take a look at the deck, the Yakshas
I told you an arrow is a three-way arrow, split arrow. I told you a split.
Both
I
told
know the name.
Extremely well.
Skill name, I explain the power.
But the Crusaders, I don't know what they're waiting for. Then the line is
what Medusa's got power, that arrow thing, split arrow thing.
Medusa power. He walks into Ucypher. He doesn't get the cogs off the scent of Bakemono, rather, a second too late.
Split arrow.
And VP manages to escape.
How does it matter though? It's a dumb down power anyway. Dumb it down says the split arrow.
Acrid has no fear in the world.
I'll
right
check
now.
It.
He's got himself the Mjolnir in addition to that Lincoln sphere, so he's able to push out the waves quickly. He's able to stand his ground. Two out of three lanes are pushed out by the Dire, and they're pushing the third lane with all five of the heroes. Around the four of the heroes and the Tinker to join shortly. This is not looking good at all for the side that was meant to
be. Double check.
It looks like the Crusaders might be forced into defense
split
for the first time in this game.
Split short.
You can see a semblance of confidence being displayed here by Appa and his boys.
Yeah.
They're walking past him.
Split short.
Threatening to do some damage on tier 2.
And
honestly,
that's helped him farm a lot of
push at this point.
A lot of
not
gold
sure what they'll be able to do on
he's
the
right now on top
to
in terms of the gold he's earned.
Do you think the clockwork picks up our hood?
He's going for the 4-star, which is the right choice here.
Yeah, okay.
Having the ability to cog in and 4-star out versus Invincible and the Wind Ranger will be such a valuable asset.
Mm-hmm. Invincible and the rest of Crusaders, they are checking the rocks where a power shot comes through. Kalnak doesn't time walk it off. Dropping those right far away, healing off the Vladimir's offering. But do Invincible and the rest of Crusaders wants to get there. Agent on the floor, hook shot out to do. Kalnak could fall off with the critical Remstar. He manages to 4-star out. BP being focused, he's dropping low. He's been brought down by Remstar. Dashin goes in on the back lines. So Kalnak with the Chronosphere. He's focusing Remstar.
Almost
goes down. But he's been sent back by Bakimono. And there's the Fiend Whip. It's on to the Jakiro while Kalnak moves on for Invincible. Dashin will fall. Make that 3. Make it 4 instead. While Bakimono just stood there and ended up going down. Remstar, the only survivor. Yakshas, they've got in ages. They've got in cheese. And the crowd is screaming Ganpati Bappa Moria, if I'm not mistaken.
We're going to the break.
Walking forward now. We'll talk about confidence of the Aegis in his pocket with the extra armor coming out from the Stranger. If you don't deal with Punk on that Bane, he's just going to ensure that you
can't talk about the time that you finish in the game.
But that was all Kalnai.
I think it was BP who got a 5-star with a hook shot on the 2.
Half
and Kalnang dropped a good chronosphere on the back lines. It was the both of them. The wide as well as the clockwork. Yeah. Working really well together. And I'm not sure, did you see Darshan pop the mech in that
power care.
I did not actually. It's small, but it's insignificant.
At least five.
Actually, yeah,
he did. He ran after the Tinker.
And that's really working for them, right? Okay.
Either way, it's a fight that goes heavily in favor of the Yakshas. Not only do they get the Aegis over there, they also find themselves a tier 2 tower in the top lane, and they show no signs of stopping. They're clearly not too bothered about having that Chronosphere in their pocket when they can just push outright like this. Appa's even got an item, so the moment they have eyes on heroes, they can just stand it out and see the missiles and laser reflections. We're looking at damage just standing on the front line now, trying to set up something for the rest of his team.
In the pit of malice, so without a care and take down this tower. Either way, the Yakshas are going to get this tower, and the Crusaders, they're working with a 14,000 net worth deficit. How do they hold? The good thing is Kalnak doesn't have the Chronosphere, and the Crusaders, they are working with no harder towers. This means that a death or a fight which results in a loss and them not having buybacks could pretty much mean a tier 3 tower at the way he needs.
So the Chrono's back online, so too is the Fiend's grip. All they're going to do is get an infusion before the fight starts on one of the two physical DPS foes on the side of Crusaders, and they'll be cruising up onto the high ground.
Spunk picked up now, he's
and he's gone for the enfeeble damage tier as well. Inside of a Chronosphere with the stone enfeeble, even he's going to be doing a fair bit of damage.
So how long does Enfeeble last?
I think this Prowlet has
lost 20 seconds.
20 seconds, that's a lot. With an 8-second cooldown.
How long is the Fiend's grip? Okay, so you still got enough time to do Enfeeble and the Fiend's grip and then whack away on someone. Okay?
You can't right kick the one.
No, I mean, after Fiend's grip ends, you can still then whack away on someone because he's only damaged from Enfeeble.
Yeah, I mean, theoretically, in a one-on-one matchup, that's not how you go for it, right? You'd probably Enfeeble Nightmare, smack him for 5 seconds,
and then maybe Fiend's grip, and then smack him for another 3.
Yep.
But yeah, in the team fight, he might Nightmare one, Enfeeble the other, then cast the Fiend's grip, and then even then have time to back away and someone.
Chip damage has begun.
CD and 18.
Day 3, taking a bit of a beating here, Acrid. Malice for a while, does walk out of it. He doesn't care, man. He's got a Shiver's guard now.
Yeah, he really shouldn't care, but he's showing them how it's done. This is how we push. And you got Appa side lanes out as well. Top lane is pushing in. Kalnak just waiting for the opportunity to hook shot.
The double fire from the Barnes is not in the idea. This is exactly what they've got. They've got all three lanes pushing in. This is the only thing left for them to do with an 8% achieve. Darshan is slowing this down as best as he can. Unfortunately, his best is not enough. And it's not like they can initiate the fight on their side either. Crusaders are not really packing the punch. They don't have any items to start the fight. It's devastating to take out a hero before it begins. Anyway, again, Acrid. He's standing on the low ground, beating up on that tail. Darson and Zeke do no damage to Acrid whatsoever. And now put to sleep. Does VP consider jumping into the back of
as much as gold as possible? Like he's going to be against really strong inventory. And good I won't say carry team, but get enough of support from the rest of the people.
What's really so that crucial, yeah. That's the tier 3 power. You see an opportunity to fight any other team in India with jumping.
Remstar has to step up.
A target that's controlled is an invitation to fight. But instead, all they need to do is put Acrid in the front. Acrid can soak up all the damage in the world. He's lost the Aegis, he's getting the mid heavily. But I got to respect the fact that Kalnag could jump in with the Chronosphere and Acrid could follow up with the Stone Gaze. He's taken a fair amount of damage, but they could take the tier 3 if they really want to.
Yeah, I don't see why they back off. This is a good team. Exactly. This is perfect because they're farming side lanes with the Tinker, they're farming the middle lane with the Hero. And they don't chip damage in the tier 3. Well, the entirety of Crusaders is basically AFK delays. They do connect the Shackle, they have the Gust coming on, they've got the Pit of Malice behind as well, but actually he's just refusing to die and even refusing to pop the cheese. He just doesn't need it at this point.
He doesn't, but if we do see another Shackle shot, he could be in a little bit of trouble if they commit the Macro Fire and everything on top of it. Now we got Appa joining them, which was...
He got him a Sass and some Potter charges as well, so he's back up to full HP.
Back up. Tinker is a glorified water boy for his team at this point.
This is such a nuisance. The mass spam means that the squishies can't get in position. Bakemono can't use his base to pick up any new creeps. He's got two siege creeps dominated on the side. Make that a third. He's actually stacking up siege creeps to try and push. This is so cheeky.
I don't know if those siege creeps are ever going to move out of the base though. Acrid still has cheese, has the Mjolnir, Dash is like best. Invincible's had enough. He goes in with the link in the spot. Enfeeble under Invincible means he has to run a penitence upon the Medusa, but Acrid doesn't care. They haven't even tickled him at this point. And Acrid just standing his ground.
The pipe is down for 60 seconds now, so those mass spams are going to be a lot more efficient. As soon as Appa joins the fray once again, they can go up, and this time Acrid might even want to jump up onto the high ground and make something happen. I'd like to see VP hookshot in now. This looks like a fight that they should take while the pipe is down for 30.
I think he goes in as soon as the tier 3 drops.
I guess that's what he's waiting for. He's just waiting for the tier 3 to go down.
Or maybe for the Raid to overcommit on top of Medusa. Darshan, 4 star ahead. I think that was VP who went into the cogs. Darshan got the
main shot.
There's a macro fight on the floor, but look at the Chronosphere. They're focusing the Underlord. Remstar under attack. The macro fight doing its work, but the cogs will push back Darshan. VP gets the kill and ends up falling down as well. A buyback on the Underlord, but the tier 3 has fallen. There's the Stone Gaze pushing back the Radiant. The Chronosphere unfortunately didn't get a kill, but the Crusaders have lost a tier 3 tower. And they're bought back on the Underlord.
Again, Punk just standing behind and grabbing that Invincible Wind Ranger when he tried to bring down Acrid. The Fiend's grip on Invincible meant that Acrid got enough time to pop his cheese, and because he popped the cheese, they got the kill on the Underlord before VP goes down, which then transitions into a tier 3 tower. High ground has been breached. 37 minutes in, Yakshas seem to be the ones in the driver's seat.
Okay, are those siege creeps still at base? The ones that Bakemono managed to control?
They're pushing mid now.
Yeah, okay. They're on the hunt. Chronosphere is on cooldown. This is the ideal time for Crusaders to find a pickoff. They want the core.
This is goddamn obvious.
It is bloody obvious.
Punk, what are you doing? We talked about how obvious this gank was.
I mean,
just barely gotten away from it. Kalnaya cut off. He sees Bakemono. He has the Diffuser Blade available if he wants to use it. Starts off with Time Dilation. Goes in on Bakemono behind though. He got Acrid in a lot of trouble. Silence and brought down. That's his killing spree ended by Invincible. And with no Punk to Enfeeble in the vicinity, things could go horribly wrong for Yakshas as the Crusaders have hit the bail button. We'll get back to the base.
I think the Crusaders will be a little pleased with themselves. They managed to kill the Medusa. This is space and time for them, and this could ensure that they get a little bit of farm on their coast.
The wages of fear.
I'm wondering if him not going in early on to start that fight is now starting to come back and hurt them, because the kill on Acrid means that he's not a god, he's not immortal at this point, and he's still fairly easy to take down. As long as the Bane is not a factor, as we saw just earlier on. Bakemono walking in from behind ended up being an unintentional bait in the river over there, which allowed them to isolate the Busa and take her down. But this time the story is going to be different, as we're seeing the entirety of the Yakshas group up at the middle lane, hoping to start the fight on their turn. And again, they've got all three lanes pushing in to help them do this.
Yeah, but if the Yakshas take this fight and Acrid ends up dying without Aegis, it could sort of backfire because the Drow's got in time, the Windrunner's got in time as well. And if somehow the Crusaders hold on to their base, they could mount a huge push which possibly cannot be stopped without committing buybacks. So they've got to respect the pushing potential coming out from the Crusaders. All it takes is a team fight that ends up going horribly wrong, and the Crusaders, before you know it, have taken a tier 2 with Shotmo.
So if the Dire Duo wants to take down Roshan, they've got themselves an observer to watch this choke point as they come in. They don't have any vision on this side of the map though, and it's not like they've taken the shrines after taking that tier 3 either. They took a shrine on the bottom side of the map, but that's not really the most useful shrine when you're trying to do Roshan. Acrid, I think he's realized this, and they're going to go for that shrine right away, while Kalnaya goes to work on Rosh. With the Diffusal Blade, Manta and the Blads, clearly he can do this by himself.
Yeah, Acrid on the shrine, Kalnaya on Roshan, and Crusaders in their base. I don't know. I don't think they can defend again. This is Roshan number 3. Mm-hmm. And Roshan, this time around, in this patch, has got stopping and has picked up a refresher off for himself.
Medusa also went for the plus 800 mana challenge at level 20, which means that she's supremely dangerous for the next fight. There's no sources of mana burn, no diffusal blades whatsoever on the side of Crusaders either, so I just don't see how they deal with an Aegis, or rather a Cheese Medusa this time around.
Yeah.
The refresher orb is on
Kalnaya. I think the correct decision.
But he's left out his BKB for it.
I guess he might come into Chronospheres and then the BKB after that.
I feel like the Aegis should have been on Acrid and then the refresher plus the Cheese.
On the void. Yeah. Definitely the refresh on the
anyway,
void.
Anyway, they've cogged in Darshan. The Shackle Shot doesn't connect really on anyone. Darshan has the Blade Nail activated already, but now he's in a lot of trouble. He gets sent back to the base. The hook shot blocked by the Chronosphere. But look who they've got inside of it. It's Remstar that gets taken down. Bunk is walking into field with the refresh Chrono entirely with Kalnayak. What the holy hell was that? A zoning Chronosphere at its finest. He doesn't give a damn, man. He is pissed off. And they'll bring down Invincible. They'll bring down Bakemono. Have fun with the triple kill. Kalnayak willing to sacrifice the Aegis for the greater good, which happens to be the barracks. Acrid takes down the barracks behind, and Darshan brings down as well. Well, it's going to be an ultra clip for Apple.
They're going to get the underlord. Kalnayak, he's walking the Aegis. They've taken a lane of barracks, and they're moving for another tier 3. No buybacks on the side of the Crusaders. How are they going to defend? Anyone who walks up takes an enfeeble and is sent right back.
Yakshas on the verge of victory here at the Ucypher League, taking down their former teammates. Acrid taking down his former teammates. You can see him cheering on as well.
Invincible's gone in, but they can Nightmare, they can control him with the Hex, the Ice Bard's there, but that just means that Senjin, who walked ahead, might have to go down. Acrid manages to bring down Invincible while VP with the Rocket Flare gets the kill on Senjin. He walks into base, he drops his items, disrespect of the highest order, but why not? Yakshas have won with a convincing lead of 32,000 net worth. And once again, the players want to be shoutcasters. A beautiful game coming up from Yakshas here.